Test, test, 1, 2. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to worship at this Feast of the Holy Trinity. And we begin our service this morning with an order for confession and forgiveness. Please rise as you are able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our gathering hymn, Come All You People. Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Our canticle of praise.
Father,
join me in the prayer of the day. God of heaven and earth, before the foundation of the universe and the beginning of time, you are the triune God, author of creation, eternal word of salvation, life-giving spirit of wisdom. Guide us to all truth by your spirit, that we may proclaim all that Christ has revealed and rejoice in the glory he shares with us. Glory and praise to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the lessons.
The first reading is from Genesis 1 and 2, 1 to 4a, 6 days of creation and the Sabbath. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was formless, void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the water, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening and morning of the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on the earth that bear fruit with seeds in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, trees of every kind bearing fruit with seeds in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and morning of the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater one to rule the day, and the lesser one to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and morning of the fourth day. And God said, "Let waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome in the sky." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let the birds multiply on earth." And there was evening and morning of the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food, and to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps upon the earth. Everything that has the breath of life, I have given every shade of green plant for you." And it is so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning of the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 8, Divine Majesty and Human Dignity, a psalm of David, and we'll read this responsively. O Lord our God,
how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You whose glory is chanted above the heavens, out of the mouth of infants and children.
You have set up a fortress against your enemies, to silence the foe and avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers,
and the stars you have set in their courses,
what are mere mortals that you should be mindful of them?
Human beings that you should care for them.
Yet you have made them a little less than divine.
With glory and honor you crown them.
You have made them rule over the works of your hands.
You have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle.
Even wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air and the fish of the sea.
And whatever passes along the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord,
how majestic is your name in all the earth.
And the second reading is from 2 Corinthians 13, 11 to 13, the final greeting and benediction. Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Donna. Please rise for the gospel acclamation.
Hallelujah, Lord and Savior, open now your Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew, the 28th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the third time today you've heard this. It was our opening greeting, as it is every Sunday. And then during the lessons, Donna revealed to us that this is what Paul wrote to close the second letter to the Corinthians. And you thought we were just making this stuff up. This is familiar Paul stuff, but also different. At the end of all Paul's letters, you always find, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you," at the end of 1 Thessalonians, Philippians, and Philemon, and Galatians, and Romans, lots of them, but always just Christ's grace. But the Corinthians, oh, the Corinthians. The church in Corinth was fighting about so much. It was a mess on so many levels. The end of Paul's letter sounds like what we might hear a parent calling out the car window to their student they just dropped off. Remember what we talked about. Make good choices. It's only because Paul believes passionately that God's own Spirit is at work in both his life and that of the Corinthians that he can't let them go, can't walk away and just found another church somewhere, or just bask in the happy relationship he enjoys with his other churches. So with this trifold blessing, I figure Paul just knew that they needed all the help they could get, more resources. Paul wants to remind them that they follow a God who loves them enough to create and deliver and make an eternal covenant. They follow a God who saves them, coming in flesh so that they might know saving grace. And they follow a God whose Spirit moves among them, even when they're talking behind each other's backs. A Spirit powerful enough to transform them from a fractured bunch into a communion of believers. This bit from 2 Corinthians and the end of Matthew, our gospel today, are the two verses in the Bible that are explicitly Trinitarian. But it would be over a century before Trinity became the shorthand way of expressing what Paul is already articulating. The whole pattern, though, of divine activity described in the New Testament shows that the Father is revealed in Christ through the Spirit. That's been what people experience. That was Paul's experience. That was why he closed his letter that way. Not because he thought it was a teachable moment about the Trinity. As one of the chosen people, Paul knew of God's love and action for the Israelites throughout history. He had been graced by a vision of Jesus on the Damascus Road, and then he had oriented his ministry around the guidance of the Holy Spirit. It's kind of ironic that we're talking about the Corinthians on the Feast of Trinity, because that's a doctrine that people have been fighting about and trying to understand for centuries. It's also ironic because the Trinity is the model and means for getting along, as Paul knew. The Feast of the Trinity is unique in that it isn't about some event. It's about a doctrine, an impossible to completely grasp doctrine. But guess what? We don't have to understand it to celebrate it, which is actually true for all the other feasts too. We can't explain how all those miraculous events happened either. There are just limits to our human ability to grasp the things of God. Our knowledge of God is accommodated to our capacity. Like Augustine said, loosely translated, if you can get your mind around it, it's not God. A God small enough to understand would not be big enough to worship. But when you read your Bible or go to Bible study or hear the lessons here on Sunday, you're not cramming for your final. You do not need to be able to explain the Trinity. You don't even have to claim to believe it. We look at God's revelation so far to help us notice it now and to help us understand our experiences. It's easy to find a lot of people with knowledge of the Bible, but are so judgmental it's hard to believe they've ever experienced the humbling forgiveness and love of God. Faith is never to be reduced to asserting facts or making the mind jump through certain hoops to arrive at particular conclusions about God. There's no intellectual discussion in the Bible about the nature of God. It's always, always somehow related to us. God is all about relationship. From the beginning of the history of Israel with Abraham, the children of Israel discovered God's uniqueness in God's oneness. The ancient pagan world didn't believe in a single God, especially one whose innermost nature was love. Some of those gods were crazy. But what Judaism clung to as hope and what Christianity announced as fulfilled at last was the belief that the one God who made the world was indeed a totally loving God who would demonstrate this love by acting within the world when Christ came to put everything right at last. And in gazing upon that loving God and learning to trust and love him in return, the early Christians found themselves embraced in a new kind of spirituality, an intimacy of trust, like children with a father, a warm security of knowing that they were loved with an everlasting love. This salvation and revelation of God continues to be revealed to us today in the Holy Spirit. So the best way to confess the Holy Spirit is to accept in plain and honest faith what God has done for us, and not let that become dry and empty formulas about God. The Trinity is best understood as a description of the Father's revelation in the Son through God's Spirit. Our celebration of the Feast of the Holy Trinity is also the celebration of the mystery of God. We see the mystery when Christ says, "I and the Father are one." And again, "The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things concerning me." We can't understand how this is possible, but we can experience it, and that's the important part. Dorothy Sayers, the English dramatist, described the Trinity in terms of drama. An idea originates with the Father as the thought comes to the dramatist. That idea becomes incarnate in the actor as the word of the Father became incarnate in the Son. The idea is shared with people in the Spirit in the same way the drama becomes a part of the audience who watches and listens. In our gospel today, Jesus sets the standard for baptism in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Isn't it interesting that he doesn't say in the names of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? We're baptized into the whole being of God, whether we understand it or not. We have been made disciples, lifelong learners, and you can't learn without the Holy Spirit, whose work is dependent upon what and who Jesus was and is. And Christ keeps pointing to the Father. So it is in the Trinity, the fullness of God, that we are discipled. Jesus sends the disciples to all nations, knowing full well that each nation is saturated in its own context, culture, language, tradition, and family systems. God created the world with diversity, not sameness. God understands difference. God understands relationship. God understands community. Conflict did not end in Corinth. In human communities, there is disagreement. Authorities constantly negotiate it. The loudest voices sometimes drown out the humble and searching one. It still happens that we privilege independence and autonomy over companionship and mutuality. We prioritize our individual rights over our care and concern for the most vulnerable among us. We're all supposed to be walking each other home, but sometimes we get turned around on the path of discipleship, and maybe we don't exactly want to be in fellowship with so many people, at least not the disagreeable and annoying ones. So isn't it good that we start off every Sunday remembering the love of a God who covenants with us anyway, the grace of a Lord who saves us anyway, the fellowship of a Spirit that dwells with us anyway? They encircle us as they work, seamlessly bound, three in one. We are offered, like the Corinthians, a challenge to see ourselves as a communion, as a fellowship of people who need one another. We get that same model of our triune God. Within the divine being, we get a glimpse of perfect fellowship, perfect communion. Father, Son, and Spirit do not merely coexist or tolerate one another. They don't take turns or split the work of being God. They do not occupy separate offices down the corporate hallway or manage separate portfolios of responsibilities. They're inextricably bound, each necessary for the holy work of the other, each full and complete because they are together. If the Trinity really is more than a bit of dusty doctrine the early church fought over, then we can't take lightly the life-changing power of the God who is relationship. It is in relationship with God, with ourselves, with each other, with the world, that we experience and embody God's nature, all schools of love. If the Trinity means anything at all, it means this. From all eternity, three divine persons have had an unbounded love affair with each other. And then, once upon an eternity, they decided to share that love with the universe of other creatures. That those creatures eventually turned out to be wholly unlovely didn't render them finally unlovable. And so the grace and the love and the fellowship keep coming. It's just God's triune nature to send it. It's just our awesome opportunity to keep getting it. Thanks be to God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Please rise for our hymn of the day, Come Join the Dance of Trinity.
Spirit, Son.
affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace.
You may be seated for the prayers. Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. Holy Three, Holy One, you call the Church to make disciples of all nations. Encourage bishops, pastors, and deacons in their proclamation of the gospel, and direct all the baptized into lives of humble service. Hear us, O God. Holy Three, Holy One, you spoke creation into being and called it good. Protect lands and waters threatened by human misuse, and sustain living creatures of every kind, wild animals, birds, fish, and every creeping thing. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Holy Three, Holy One, you have given humankind authority over the earth. Raise up leaders who listen earnestly, speak honestly, and govern thoughtfully. Heal divisions between nations that we might agree with one another and live in peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy Three, Holy One, you promise to be with us always to the end of the age. Surround those most in need of your healing presence, any who are lonely, all who are grieving, and those who are sick, especially Connie Angel, Norma Erickson, Martha Rooney, Deanne Larson, Dorothy Carlton, Arnold Lang, Shirley Wengel, Eric Oliver, Lloyd and Erla Meyer, Glenn Moen, Alan Sunby, Isabella Sunby, Jean Heeg, Louise Taylor, Laura Lee Orthner, Burnett and Arlene Olson, Jake and Margaret Dick, Jean White, Artis Wall, Jean Garthus, Marlene Arndt, Drinda Koenig, Val Morstad, Tracy Moen, Val Reed, Ted Reeves, Beryl Chapman, Ellie Moe, Irene Sunby, Ray Item, Shirley Fraser, Faye Silzer, Helen McGovern, Catherine Berg, Ansgar Tuning, Evelyn Senft, Lillian Basandowski, Louise Bush, Mary Enns, Lucy Zimmerman, Jenny Fontaine, Jean Straub, Marion Solberg, Margaret Elias, Helen Sather, and Edna Hapke. We pray for those celebrating birthdays: Ellie Binner, Lynn Hilderman, Carrie Lynn, Garrett Unger, Lois Noble, Emily Erlinson, Marlillis Bush, Louise Taylor, Rhianne Smith, Carrie Taylor, Kate Pribble, Casey Brandt, Jasper Band, Wayne Braun, Diane Tritton, Samantha Schroeder, and also the anniversaries of Donna Burgoyne and Neil Wallace, Darris and Judy White, Larry and Valerie Belther, and Don and Lynn Hilderman. We pray also in our Swift Current Ministerial for Faith Evangelical Missionary Church. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy Three, Holy One, you set the earth on its axis and we experience the seasons. Strengthen those enduring challenges this summer, those who suffer in the heat, parents overwhelmed by childcare responsibilities, and children experiencing food insecurity outside of school. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We take this moment in silence to lift to you the concerns on each heart today. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy Three, Holy One, you give rest when our work is done. We give thanks for all the saints who now rest in you, confident in the promise of resurrection life in the age to come. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. This is the time when we recognize our offering gathered at the back. Please rise for our offertory hymn. In thanksgiving for the fruitful abundance of God's creation, we give back a portion of what we have received, and we offer these gifts and ourselves as instruments of God's ever new creation. Food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn your hearts towards those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care. And prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You reveal your glory as the glory of your Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, one Lord, one God, ever to be adored in your eternal glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will
even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us. And believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, and in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And we say together the words our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lamb of God. Break bread together. Thank you. shed for you. Blood of Christ 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 shed for you. The 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 blood of Christ shed for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. Shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. May the precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you into life everlasting. Please rise for our post-communion canticle.
Sight of every people.
we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Go forth in the name of God the Creator, whose strength empowers us, in the name of Christ the Redeemer, whose love transforms us, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, whose presence guides us, and go with the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our sending hymn, Go to the World. New words, familiar tune, I think.
W would like to thank everyone who came to the Spring Tree Tea and Saved by Grace for being the entertainment and all the pies that were baked and everyone who set up, served, and cleaned up. $628.85 plus a lot of food went to the Salvation Army, so very successful. Pastor Greg will be in Cabri on Tuesday. The Esther Circle Bible Study will be at 7 o'clock at night here with the potluck. No quilting, but the Hope Circle Bible Study will be at the church at 1:30, while Saved by Grace will be at the Meadows at 2 on Thursday. Next Sunday is our graduation milestone. Anyone graduating from grade 12 or some other secondary program, let the office know. I'm really sad to say I'm going to miss that. We have to be in Toronto. Our daughter Shannon has a competition there. And we've never been to Toronto, so if you want to advise us on where to stay or how to get around, that would be helpful. But I'm sure it's going to be fabulous next Sunday. The last Sunday of June, July, and August, we'll have 10 extra minutes at the beginning of the service to sing some of those old favorite hymns we don't get to often enough. We need readers. There's a sign-up sheet out on the whiteboard. And another thank you to all of the gardeners who planted our little garden and everyone who donated peat moss, compost, money for flowers, and the labor of rototilling and raking. It looks great and will look even better. Thank you so much. The next Salvation Army community meal is Wednesday, June 7th. There is a sign-up sheet also on the whiteboard in the narthex for 8 to 10 volunteers to serve and clean up. You arrive at 7, usually at 4, usually done by 7. Val Belter is the lady to answer your questions. And lastly, the box is still out to collect any Bibles or Christian books that will be going to Regina to be distributed around the world. We have any more announcements I don't know about? Roy. Nice. Take some of those. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Good morning.